Hi everyone, and welcome to this latest edition of Ascertia On, our informative online series looking into hot topics in the world of digital trust. My name is Mike Hathaway, Chief Product Officer for Ascertia, and today I'm joined by John Jolliffe, who's Product Manager for Signing Hub.
Hi Mike, hi everyone.
In today's edition, we'll be going back to the basics to consider the different types of electronic and digital signature. The difference between E and D signatures, or electronic and digital, is something that trips up many organizations, and there's a plethora of terminology covering overlapping legal, technical, and marketing ideas.
But by the end of this session, we hope you'll understand what they are, how they're made, and when they're used. And you'll be thinking about how this relates to your own deployment and the guardrails you might want to put in place to ensure that you're using the correct type of signature in the correct place.
So let's kick this off by considering what e-signatures replace wet ink signatures on a piece of paper. Ink signatures carry legal value still, but they have some challenges. They can be easily forged, they change over the passage of time, and they consume resources like paper, postage. They can take time to finalize, and they do have to be stored somewhere.
Now, of course, these are all issues that can be addressed with electronic signatures. That's why they exist. But depending on where you are, legally speaking, any electronic process that indicates the acceptance of an agreement or contract can be an e-signature. Maybe a tick box in a digital document, clicking a button to accept some terms, or using a mouse or stylus to write your signature or name.
That's right. But when you use an e-signature application, you get some additional important benefits. Apart from saving time and paper, e-signature applications automate the gathering of signatures from different parties to save time. The application securely controls the end-to-end signing process and seals the document, so you can prove that document contents have not been altered. And you get an additional evidence report to capture data about the signature if there's any kind of dispute. And using an application gives you a mechanism to control where the documents are stored after they're signed.
Now, that almost sounds too good to be true. And there is a trade-off, because the most convenient and easy to use e-signatures may not help you solve one of the most important issues with wet ink signatures: forgery and being able to prove who signed what. And that's because most basic or simple e-signatures work on the basis of a very simple form of identification. The signer's email, or maybe their phone number, or both. For most use cases, that's absolutely enough proof. The email or phone number and the signature, and maybe the context in which the document was sent and signed, they give you enough comfort that it's a real agreement. But if that signature is contested, you'll only be able to prove that the document was sent to a particular location and that somebody at that location made a mark on the page. A signer can always claim that their email account or phone wasn't under their control and that someone else signed in their place. There are plenty of court cases on exactly this type of thing. So if you're worried about an agreement being contested in court, you need a kind of signature that provides much greater assurance that the signer really is who they say they are and that they agreed to the document.
That's right. Enter digital signatures. This term is probably the single most confusing thing about e-signatures, because what's electronic has to be digital, right? Because here the word digital is used differently to refer to the technology used to generate the signature. With digital signatures, the signer's identity is bound to the document using something called a digital certificate. Certificate is issued to the signer by a trusted source, that's someone who can vouch for the identity of the signer. That could be an employer or a regulated third party known as a trusted service provider or a certification authority. The signer then uses their digital certificate to cryptographically bind their signature, containing proof of their identity, to the document.
So that explains the digital part, but it's important to realize that not all digital signatures are equal. We need to consider the different elements that go into making a digital signature, as they affect how much you can rely on that signature. Now, there's three concepts that we need to bear in mind: the type of digital certificate used, the format of the digital signature, and then something called the chain of trust. But let's look at that first point, the type of digital certificate, first. Here, it's the strictness of the identity verification process and the security controls applied when issuing that certificate that directly relate to the trustworthiness and therefore the legal evidential weight of a digital signature. There are basically four categories of certificate which have progressively strict controls. Firstly, self-signed certificates, and they can be issued by anyone to themselves without any external identity vetting. Technically, yes, it's a digital signature, but the absence of external ID verification can expose an organization to risk.
Yeah, this is a big risk, and actually something that the new Ascertia certificate locator is designed in part to address. This will help identify these type of untrustworthy certificates.
Right. And then the next level is certificates that are issued by a corporate certificate authority. It's the organization itself that validates an employee's identity and issues the digital certificate. Again, there's no external identity vetting, so it's not a signature that can be relied upon by anyone outside that organization. Next level is the Adobe Approved Trust List, or AATL, which actually has technical requirements that define the level of identity proofing required in order for the signature to be publicly trusted in Adobe Acrobat or Adobe Reader software. Members of the AATL are audited against relevant standards. Then finally, at the top of the pile, we have the most trusted kind of certificate known as a qualified electronic signature, or QES, in the EU, and it might be called something different outside the EU. These signatures have even stricter standards around the identity verification and specify which technologies can be used to generate the certificates.
So as you can see, there's a progressive scale around the security of a digital certificate. Similarly, there's a progressive scale around the types of digital signatures and signature format. So the industry has settled on the PDF format as the most secure container for preserving both the presentation and layout of a document, as well as capturing all of the cryptographic information associated with the signature. International standards bodies have developed four different levels of PDF advanced electronic signature, or PADS. This is the format that reflects the information they contain. So this is where things start becoming a bit of a mouthful. Baseline PADS digital signatures remain valid as long as the signing certificate is valid, i.e. it hasn't been revoked or it hasn't naturally expired.
Okay, before you go on, just explain what does expired mean and what does revoked mean.
Sure, no problem. So expired, actually, both terms are pretty self-explanatory. So expired is a natural security mechanism that's present in all certificates. When they're issued, they have a natural expiry date, very similar to passports, ID cards, driver's licenses. This is the point in time when the certificate's life comes to an end. Revoked is another word that technically covers cancelled. This could happen if the TSP or the trust service provider that issued the certificate has suffered a security breach. So all of the certificates issued by that TSP can no longer be considered reliable to confirm someone's identity.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
The next level is PADS T. These signatures add a trusted timestamp token from a trusted source. This helps to prove that the document existed at a specific point in time. Next, we have PADS LT signatures. Again, building upon B and T, this embeds all of the cryptographic materials required to validate the signature offline. And then finally, PADS LTA, again, building on the previous signature formats, adds a cryptographic timestamp token from a trusted source to the document, enabling it to be validated in the future, even if the signing algorithm or certificates used to sign the document have expired.
Okay, that's the signature format. Quite a mouthful. The third and final ingredient is the chain of trust. You may know digital certificates are often issued through multiple layers of trusted entities. At the top level, there's always a trusted root certification authority, often managed by a national government authority or a commercial trust service provider. And the trusted root CA certifies the operations of specially approved subordinate CAs. The certificates that are issued and managed by the root CA, and the job of the issuing CA is to issue signing certificates and then to provide all the information needed to validate certificates and revoke or replace them when needed. So that's the full chain of trust that links the root and any issuing CA certificates and that's needed for any business application to decide whether to trust the certificate or the signature created by the certificate.
Okay, so it's the combination of certificate type, signature format, chain of trust that give digital signatures their legal weight. There are also elements that are needed to be able to validate the digital signature and to see what extent it can be legally relied upon and for how long. We address signature validation in a separate episode of Ascertia On.
Okay, so we've covered in quite some detail the differences between e-signatures and digital signatures, and we've explained the different kinds of digital signature, but how does this practically affect organizations? Well, in part, it's a question of risk management. You see, most jurisdictions give digital signatures, because of the ID verification from a trusted provider, much greater legal weight. So if you're worried about being able to defend a signature in court somewhere, you'll want to choose the signature type that allows you to defend the agreement if contested in the countries where you do business.
Yep, that's right. So the other side is compliance. In some countries, there are laws that stipulate that certain kinds of document can only be e-signed with a specific kind of digital signature. If you use an e-signature where you shouldn't, or the wrong kind of signature, you don't have an enforceable agreement or contract. Or you might have rules that apply to organizations operating in a particular sector, such as life sciences, that may require internal records to be signed in a way that ensures the data hasn't been changed or that properly captures someone's consent to participate in a trial, for instance.
Now, all of these rules can, of course, create a complex operating environment for organizations using e-signatures. The situation is that if you get the signature type wrong, you can have legal or compliance issues. And if you use a digital signature where a simple e-signature would do, you're introducing unnecessary cost and complexity into your business. The good news, I suppose, is that Ascertia products like ADSS Server and Signing Hub, they support all these signature types out of the box. And we provide granular tools so that you can enact the internal guardrails you need to ensure that you're using the right signature type in the right place.
That's great. Thanks, John. And that's it for this edition of Ascertia On. We hope you can, we hope you have a better understanding of the different types of electronic signature and digital signatures and why the differences can matter so much for your organization. And also how Ascertia products like ADSS Server and Signing Hub can help you to ensure you're using the right type of signature where and when you need it. So please share any thoughts, comments, or get in touch if you have any further questions. And we hope you'll tune in to another edition of Ascertia On in the near future. Take care. Bye now.